Peace be to this house and all who dwell herein. Peace be to you in your homes and all who dwell with you there. Today is the third Sunday after Pentecost, and Pastor Zumwalt continues the summer preaching series with the second commandment today. You'll remember that last week with the first commandment, we were having instruction on what or who is in our hearts. This week with the second commandment, the emphasis is what's on our lips and our tongue, according to Blessed Martin Luther's Large Catechism. Let us rise and make confession of our sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained minister of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh,
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of gods and Lord of lords, you are the author of the best. Graft into us a love for you. Increase our devotion. Nourish us with what is good. And vigilantly watch over us for whom you care. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated for the reading of Holy Scripture.
The first lesson is from the 19th chapter of 1 Kings. And the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Mehulah, you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death. And the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." So he departed from there and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he was with the 12th. Elijah passed by him and cast his cloak upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow you." And he said to him, "Go back again, for what have I done to you?" And he returned from following him, and took the yoke of oxen, and sacrificed them, and boiled their flesh with the yokes of the oxen, and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he arose and went after Elijah and assisted him. This is the word of the Lord. We read responsively, hymn 16. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. Say to the Lord, "You are my Lord. I have no good apart from you." As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot.
The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance.
I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure.
For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption.
You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand our pleasures forevermore.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen. The second lesson is from the fifth chapter of Galatians. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom. Brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the days drew near for him to be received up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him who went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. But the people would not receive him, because his face was set towards Jerusalem. And when his disciples James and John saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to bid fire come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them, and they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. To another he said, follow me. But he said, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. But he said to him, leave the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Another said, I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home. Jesus said to him, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We continue on the back cover of the bulletin with Luther's Table of Duties. This section of the Small Catechism, many of you probably never saw in your childhood if you were cradle Lutherans, but it is part of the original Small Catechism. Certain passages of Scripture for various holy orders and positions by which these people are to be admonished. A special lesson about their office and service. So reading together to workers of all kinds, bondservants, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with a sincere heart as you would Christ, not by the way of eye service as people pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with a good will as to the Lord and not to man, knowing that whatever good anyone does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is a bondservant or is free, Ephesians 6, 5-8, and to employers and supervisors. Masters, do the same to them and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and that there is no partiality with him, Ephesians 6, 9. Now on the previous page at the top, let us pray together the prayer. O God, the strength of all who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers, and because in our weakness we can do nothing good without you, give us the help of your grace, that in keeping your commandments we may please you both in will and deed, through your Son Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. The sermon is based upon the second commandment, Luther's explanation in the Large Catechism, and an interplay with the epistle lesson from Galatians 5. So grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Last week we thought by way of introduction that the Ten Commandments tell us what our Heavenly Father wants. In both negative and in positive ways, our Father tells us, not that way, but this. So then last week we learned in the first commandment that our Father does not want us to fear, love, and trust in other gods, but rather his word declares, and perhaps you remember, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding, Proverbs 3:5. So our Father wants our hearts to be fixed firmly on him. And this week, as Pastor introduced, we learn in the second commandment, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. This means our God does not want us to use his name for evil, false, or blasphemous purposes, as if God's last name were damn or something to that effect, but rather, he wants us to call upon him with prayer, praise, and thanksgiving. So the second commandment is then not merely kept by avoiding foul language that invokes God's name. We do our Father's will when whom we believe in our hearts, we confess with our lips. So this week, the passage is from King David, Psalm 145, and I'll say, my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and your response will be, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Psalm 145:21, My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Psalm 145, 21. So let's try that now. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Psalm 145, 21. One more time. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Psalm 145, 21. You've heard the word orthodoxy. Literally in the Greek, it means right praise or right worship. In theology, orthodoxy bears the sense of right teaching as opposed to its opposite, heterodoxy, which is literally something like other than right teaching or other than right praise. Because our Father wants us to trust him with all our heart, as we learned last week, what is on our lips ought to cohere with whom is in our hearts. Therefore, trusting the wrong things, trusting the wrong persons, will be made known with our lips. So let's think clearly about that and listen to Blessed Martin Luther in the Large Catechism, where he writes, God's name must not be appealed to falsely or taken upon the lips while the heart knows well enough or should know that the truth of the matter is different. This is what happens with people who take oaths in court, where one side lies against the other. For God's name cannot be misused worse than for the support of falsehood and deceit. Dr. Luther continues, but the greatest abuse occurs in spiritual matters. These have to do with the conscience. When false preachers rise up and offer their lying vanities as God's word. Luther says, now you understand what it means to take God's name in vain. In some, it means A, to use his name simply for purposes of falsehood, B, to assert in God's name something that is not true, or C, to curse, swear, use spells, and in short, to practice whatever wickedness one may. So the opposite, we will say with King David, rightly using God's name, my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Psalm 145, 21. Now, St. Paul's letter to the Galatians that we began looking at last week begins with a rather serious pen lashing because the church in Galatia has fallen prey to the false teaching of preachers who have insisted, now you Gentiles have to first become Jews in order to be Christians. So in the language of today, those false teachers have pushed identity politics on their hearers by insisting that it's something other than holy baptism that would be the mark of right relationship with the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And to that, Paul says no. Today, Paul clarifies that holy baptism does not give Christians freedom to do what we want, what is traditionally called licentiousness, like you have a license to do wrong. Holy baptism is not affirmation of how we see ourselves or how we understand our own lives in this world. Rather, the Holy Spirit uses the gospel of servant love, agape, of our Lord Jesus Christ, the one crucified to save us from sin, death, and the old evil one. The Spirit of God uses that to capture our hearts. He calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies. The Holy Spirit puts right word on our lips. He leads us to walk with Jesus. Heterodoxy, which is the wrong kind of love, is really not love, but is indeed the narcissistic desires of the old Adam or Eve. And that's what Paul means when desires of the flesh. He's talking about the old sinner that remains even after baptism. And that old sinner, that old Adam or Eve, must be drowned daily. So long as we Christians are subject to this unique biological life that began when we were first conceived. So brothers and sisters, when we're struggling with wrong thoughts and wrong desires, and oftentimes people will say to me, Pastor, I really am struggling with this wrong thought or this wrong desire. These are works which Paul says are evident sins of the flesh. And this means that rather than to be petrified by that or even to be undone by that. Rather, it's to recognize, no, the Holy Spirit is working on us. The Holy Spirit is working in us. The Holy Spirit is saying, that's not who you are. He calls us back to our baptism, where we have been crucified with the Lord Jesus Christ. Many people don't understand that. When Paul talks about being crucified with Christ, he's always talking about baptism, where we are joined to Jesus' death and resurrection. And so in holy baptism, we receive our true identity. Our Father calls us by name, child of God. We are His. So the Holy Spirit is working on you when you're struggling, reminding you, that's not who you are, that's who you are, child of God. Next week, we'll be reasoning together about the purpose of the Sabbath, namely that God is calling us out of the world. That's literally what the term ecclesia, the word we translate as church, that's what it means. God calls us out of the world of false teaching to assemble with Him for right praise, to assemble with Him for right teaching. We should say this often enough because many times Protestants have this sense that one can be sort of a Christian out there isolated, as if the life in the Holy Trinity was some sort of solitary existence. You know, it's me and Jesus. No, the antidote to the desires of the flesh of the old Adam, the old Eve, will not be found by slipping into a private prayer closet or sitting in the easy chair with the open Bible, but rather it is to come to the services of God's house, where there is right praise, where there is right teaching. So let's say again with King David, my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless His holy name forever and ever, Psalm 145, 21. We'll talk about this more in a couple of weeks. Martin Luther wrote that being a parent is the most important calling, the most important vocation in life. First, because bringing children into the world delights the God whose first command was be fruitful and multiply. And in 2 weeks, we'll certainly say more about the importance of the marriage of one man and one woman. June has always been sort of the marriage month in the past, so we'll be talking more about the marriage of one man, one woman. Luther wrote, parents are to be the bishops and the pastors of their own homes. He wrote the small catechism for parents. And so in worship, we've been saying for, I think, about 8 or 9 years, a portion of the small catechism each week, and it's to remind parents to go home and teach your children the Christian faith. And it's to remind us adults, this is what we were supposed to learn as children, to learn from God's word. Now think about why it's important to teach the children. There are some teachers, there are many politicians, certainly many entertainers, there are video games, there's popular music, many of our children's peers, and sadly, many parents who are captive to the desires of the flesh. They're driven by the old Adam or old Eve. A recent Gallup poll said that 32% of Americans between the ages of 18 and 29 say they do not believe in God. 32%, the highest number yet recorded. It makes you wonder, well, if they had checked with younger ones, would the percentage be that much, or would it be even worse? Again, there's so many other stories, so many types of false teaching out there, that people literally do not know who the Lord God is. Remember how before our Lord Jesus ascended, He declared to 120 disciples that included both men and women in Acts 1:8, He said, "You shall be my witnesses." Now let's paraphrase to get the sense of what He means to us. You shall be my witnesses in Southeast North Carolina, in this state, in this nation, and to the ends of the earth. When we, the baptized, gather together to struggle together against the desires of the flesh, when we rightly trust God with our hearts, when we confess God with our lips, when we walk with the Lord Jesus in the Spirit, we are witnesses to the triune God. So today, when you answered the Holy Spirit's call to get up, get out of bed, get out of your houses, to come together to assemble as church for worship, you used God's name rightly. Even though some are watching right now would much rather be here, But because they're sick, because they're infirm, because they're shut in, because they're struggling with COVID right now, you would rather be right here. And because you've assembled with us online, nevertheless, you are using God's name rightly, gathering for worship. This week, when you go out, and if you have children in your influence and care, when you teach children the meaning of their baptism, this is who you are. When you engage in fraternal conversation, those who have forgotten who they are, that they've fallen away from baptism, when you invite an unbaptized friend or family member to assemble here with you for worship next week, you will be using God's name rightly. As you return to your baptism daily, you will use God's name rightly, confessing to him, "My conscience is troubled. There are things that I have done and things that I have left undone that I know are not your will, I know are not right." As you walk in the Holy Spirit daily, you will use God's name rightly, exhibiting the fruit of the Spirit: servant love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and the tough one for our age, self-control. Our vocation, our calling as the children of God, whom the Father says we are in baptism, our calling is to be Christ's body in the world. So let us one more time with King David rightly use God's name. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Psalm 145:21. Perhaps you know the old chorister's prayer: Father, grant that what we say with our lips we may believe in our hearts, and what we believe in our hearts we may show forth in our lives through our Lord Jesus Christ. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray with the Lord Jesus Christ for the unity and renewal of his church on earth, for Bishops Eaton and Smith, for Francis, Bartholomew, and all bishops, for all pastors, including Peter Hoyer, Marvin Shedler, Robert Kuppler, Michael Bergbauer, Joel Kettner, and your servant, for our seminarian, Robert Shivers, for all church workers and musicians, for Stephen ministers, for the people of God, and for all people according to their needs. Holy Father, grant to your church on earth an extra measure of your Holy Spirit, that the bride of Christ may use your name rightly by calling on you with prayer, praise, and thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Generous Father, we thank you for the birth of Theo Braden Thornburg and for the gift of every life, born and unborn. Preserve from evil all pregnant women and their babies, especially Sarah Knoll, Brianna Johnson, Lauren Capozio, and their children. We give you thanks for the birthdays of Johanna Hill, Mary Pollard, Art Dingfelder, Kelsey Johns, and Denise Benoit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Father, we ask your blessing upon those joined in Christian marriage, that they may be signs of the love Christ has for his bride, the church. We give thanks for those celebrating wedding anniversaries, Randy and Sheila Mallow, Andy and Liz Rappold, Frank and Marty Felter, Larry and Norma Troutman, and Howard and Lonnie Boyerman. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate Father, show your kindness and mercy to the Ukrainian people, to earthquake victims in Afghanistan, and to Ed Ludeker, Maureen Ritchie, Rod Andrew, Harry and Carol Komeski, Bill Baldwin, Lauren Thornburg, Elaine Mattis, Ken Manning, Jackie Phillips, Lois Kuppler, Kay Guder, Patty Messino, Margaret French, Kay Thompson, Carolyn Hooker, Megan McKinney, Joel Peterson, Dennis Hall, Bob Benjamin, Marty Felter, Barbara Duff, John Tullis, Howard and Lonnie Boyerman, Arthur and Barbara Moore, Nate Hallway, Matthew Hall, Nora Rutland, Peggy Barr, David Hunsberger, Alexandra Schwartz, Brigitte Walters, Vivian Alexander, Sue and Terry Miller, Barbara and Don Butzin, Sandra Marshburn, Gretchen Donaldson, Leslie Long, Alice Copeland, Amy Kelm, and Lacey. For those yet fighting COVID, for the suffering and the dying, the grieving, especially the families and friends of Ruth Costello and Luke Rooks, and those we name aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, grant that we, who know our hunger and thirst for your Son's true body and most precious blood, may always yearn more deeply for your eternal life and love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Into your hands, Heavenly Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. On the inside, on the inside of your bulletin, you will find an insert that has particular announcements. Just a couple to take note of. There are new phone directories. They're yellow. They're on a table close to the double glass doors. Please take one copy per household. And if you want to bring back your old ones and put in the box for recycling, you can do that. Chris Kendall Mock sponsorship forms are out there, and we appreciate the more sponsors there are, the less overhead we have. And so we appreciate those who can be sponsors. There are several other announcements in the bulletin. Thankfully, folks have stood up and been counted for helping the finance team, so we don't need any more signups for the finance team in July. Last but not least, a couple of things just to remind you, July 17th, between services, there is a Stephen Ministry interest meeting. You're thinking maybe God's calling you to be a Stephen minister and you want to know more about it. So July 17th in the library. And last but not least, it's a long ways off, but summer gets busy, and so want to get on your calendars. Saturday, August the 20th is the next New Disciples class. This is for those who are new to the Lutheran Church, curious about how we practice the Christian faith. It's part of the process for joining, but if you attend, there are no strings attached. So it's a chance to have a little bit of deeper conversation about how do Lutherans practice the Christian faith. Saturday, August the 20th from 9 to noon. Please rise.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us show a sign of peace to those not of our household with a bow or a wave. Peace to you, Father. Peace.
Because of what the Lord has done for us.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, you warm and feed us through the faithful shining of the summer sun. We bring these offerings of praise and pray that you will shine on us forever with the brightness of your grace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your glorious name and join their unending hymn. Let us pray. You are indeed holy, almighty, and merciful God. You are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Having come into the world, he fulfilled for us your holy will and accomplished our salvation. He, our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Remembering therefore his holy incarnation, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. And we implore you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, that we and all who share in the body and blood of your Son may be filled with heavenly peace and joy, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be sanctified in soul and body, and have our portion with all your saints in light. All honor and glory are yours, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us thy peace.
Take a
body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, your fingerprints of love are on this world you help your Father make. But in this bread and wine you show yourself that we may truly see. By your Spirit, help us trust your saving work, that we may then imprint your love on everyone we meet. We bless you now and evermore. Amen.
Amen.
I will strive to pray daily, worship weekly, read the Bible, serve at and beyond St. Matthew's, be in relationship to encourage spiritual growth in others, and give of my time, talents, and resources.
Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.